While we wait for the last one, I look for the chalk. Ma tu mi rimetti qualche pezzetto di gesso in più, che sono rimaste su tutte caccolette. Niente di grave, eh? Forse sì, boh, dimmi te.
Per il break facciamo la foto.
Ah, sì, dai, assolutamente sì, una giornata fantastica. Approfittiamo. Dipende se preferisci farlo al break o alla fine.
No, facciamo il break.
Ok.
Okay. Ah, poi
ne
riprendiamo
ancora un po'. Ok, so it's a long time we don't see, so maybe I have to do a recap, at least remind you where we were. So we are studying the spherical PSP model. As a simple but still interesting model for disordered systems, and we choose this spherical PSP model because having a multi-spin, actually p-spin interacting Hamiltonian, we expect, as in first-order phase transition, that states are much better defined around the critical temperature, so where the physics changes via a phase transition from the paramagnetic behavior to a new spin glass behavior. Okay, so what we uncover about this model, or actually what I told you, because we didn't prove everything, that at zero temperature, if you look at the minima of the Hamiltonian, there are exponentially many minima of the Hamiltonian at different energy levels, and by defining the complexity sigma as the limit of n going to infinity, 1 over n, the log of the number of minima of a given energy, the Hamiltonian over n. By defining the complexity in this way, what we found, actually what I told you, because we didn't compute it still explicitly, is that the complexity exists, is non-zero, is well-defined, and is positive defined in a region between a minimum value and what we call a threshold value, e-min and e-threshold, okay? Beyond the threshold value, essentially, as we'll see today, there are not real roots for the equation defining the complexity, and below the minimum value, the complexity is negative, being accounting of something, it cannot be, the log of the counting of something cannot be negative, okay? This something must be at least one, okay? Here we are. Now what we want to do, we want to take back the TAP free energy that we derive, and we can write this way as Q to the P half the Hamiltonian. Actually, let me write directly the energy at zero temperature. You remember we rewrote the magnetization variables as square root of Q times variables satisfying the spherical constraint. And so this part was the Hamiltonian computed on these variables, and is enough to keep the zero energy of that state. And then we had one more part that is, we call it R of Q and beta. And R of Q and beta, we have an explicit expression thanks to the Plekka expansion to the second order. This is the TAP free energy. And it's given by one, minus 1 over 2 beta log of 1 minus Q. This the entropic term. So log 1 minus Q is the entropic term of these Gaussian variables, which are we computed explicitly. And here we have minus T. Usually in the free energy, you have U minus TS. So the energy minus temperature times the entropy. And so this is the entropic term. And then we have one more term, which is minus beta fourth 1 plus P minus 1 Q to the P minus P Q to the P minus 1. This also we computed together, and this the so-called Onsager reaction term that you have to take into account if you have a disordered model, okay? So this is where we are. So essentially at zero temperature, we know what is the structure of states. Now the following question we want to answer is, what happened to this structure of local minima when we switch on the temperature? So now we also put back this term, because if you set the temperature to zero, so beta equal to infinity, well, this term trivially goes to zero, and you can prove that also this term goes to zero. So the TAP free energy reduces to computing the minima of the only the energetic part if you're at zero temperature. Now we want to put the temperature back into the problem. And so we want to look really at the structure of the free energy, so the structure of states in free energy. So at zero temperature, we know what it is. It's essentially there is a region here between E min and E threshold where there are states. Now, I would like to convince you by just doing some simple computation that the structure is this one. So each state can be, say, extended to finite temperature by solving the only equation that we still have to solve, so the derivative with respect to Q equal to zero, because the derivative with respect to this variable equal to zero do correspond to minima of the Hamiltonian. And we'll try to follow these states in some way, okay? I draw it this way, and so this, you have to intend as the free energy of the states, and we'll see that all this region is full of states. So there are states at any of these points, which means there exist at a given temperature states in a certain range of free energies, okay? And so then we have to understand what is the thermodynamic of a model having so many states of different free energy levels, okay? So how can I convince you that each state can be, modified from the minimum of the energy function to a minimum of the free energy TAP free energy. Well, we have to solve the equation, the derivative of the TAP free energy with respect to Q equal to zero, because we already solve the equation taking the derivative with respect to sigma I, which is computing, which is equivalent to compute the minimum of the energy function. But there is still one more equation, which is taking the derivative with respect to Q. If you take the derivative with respect to Q, you get the following equation. Okay, it's just simple algebra. 1 over 2 beta 1 minus Q, sorry, 1 over 1 minus Q, which is the derivative of the log. Then you have one more term, which is the derivative of the energetic term, so it's p half q to the p half minus 1 times the energy. This is the intensive energy, this is why I use the lowercase letter. And then you take the derivative of this term with respect to q, and you simplify a little bit, and you get beta quarter p times p minus 1 times q to the p minus 2 1 minus q equal to 0. This is the equation that you have to solve. It looks nasty in the sense that it's a nonlinear equation in q. Still, if you do the following change of variables, and you introduce the variable z, which is defined as beta times 1 minus q times q to the p half minus 1, then this equation becomes equivalent to this second order equation, which is very simple to solve, which is 1 plus PEZ plus P minus 1 half Z square, that everybody knows how to solve, because now it's a second order equation in Z. Okay? So you have to solve this equation, and you have to remember that Z is a function of Q and beta. You are interested in computing Q. So what is our interest? We want to understand, given a generic state of energy E, where it goes when I switch on the temperature. So when I switch on the temperature, I also have to solve this equation for a given beta value. And I want to solve it in Q, but in Q this equation looks very ugly, because it's a nonlinear equation. Changing the variable, I can easily solve in Z. And then I reconstruct Q from Z, okay? So the solution of this equation in Z is very simple. Actually, you have two. You have to choose one of the two according to, again, physical requirements. I don't have time to enter too much in detail, but essentially you choose the solution such that the overlap Q, which is, remember that, I forgot in the summary to remind you that Q is defined as 1 over n sum over I magnetization square. Well, actually, it comes from here, but is worth reminding what Q is. It's the self-overlap, so it's something that tells you how what is the shape of the minimum you are in. So if you, essentially, if all the magnetization are very close to 1, this means that any two copies belonging to that state are very similar magnetization, so they are very similar. If m is very small, it means that each spin can fluctuate a lot, and so if you take two copies in that state, their self-overlap, so their similarity, this is a notion of similarity, is very small. Okay? So Q is a notion of similarity. And what we expect in general is that for temperature equal to zero, the similarity is 1, in the sense that the two copies are forced to be in a minimum, while when I switch on the temperature, there is also an entropic term. So if you take two systems in a valley, two copies, at zero temperature, they end up exactly in the same minimum, so their similarity is 1. So you expect at t equals 0, q equal 1, so they are perfectly identical. Then you put some temperature, and so you expect the system to fluctuate at a given energy level above the minimum, so you have thermal excitation, above in a valley, okay? A hot ball in a valley. It fluctuates, and so these two systems now, they are fluctuating here, and the size of the valley is given by this Q, which is a notion of similarity. So when you make the temperature higher, the similarity goes down. So in general, you expect that Q as a function of the temperature starts always from 1 and then it goes down. This is the physical expectation given the meaning of this overlap parameter, which is nothing but a notion of similarities between two copies of the same system put in the same state. Okay? Now, if you look at the two solutions of that quadratic equation, you realize that for one solution, Z, which is related to Q, brings you a function Q of T, which is monotonously decreasing in T. The other solution gives you a solution which is monotonously increasing, which is non-physical. So you don't expect that when you make a system when you bring a system to a higher temperature where two systems can more easily decorrelate, so more easily go to small values of the overlap increases, okay? So by choosing the right root of this equation, you can write Z as minus E. Ah, one more thing. This equation looks an equation with all positive coefficients. So it seems not to have any root, but you have to remember that the energy is a negative quantity. I see, I always plot energy on the negative side of the axis. So these are negative coefficients, otherwise you will not have any root. So minus E again is positive, minus square root of E square minus E threshold square divided T minus 1, where I introduce this E threshold. Well, actually, I recall because I already introduced in the definition of this complexity is defined this way. Okay, is the definition of the threshold. It's just the solution of this equation. And so Z is related to E, and they are so if in general if E increases, Z increases. So they are. The Z is an increasing function of E, and you can see that the argument of the square root must be positive in order to have a real value for Z. And this implies that a solution to this equation exists only if, so the solution exists if and only if the absolute value of the energy is larger than the absolute value of the threshold energy. You have to remember that we are working with negative quantities, so asking the absolute value of the energy to be larger than the absolute value of the threshold energy is equivalent to ask, in our setting, the energy to be strictly smaller than the threshold energy. Okay? Because we are working with negative variables. Okay? So this say that is another way of saying that this equation that you are required to solve in order to find the minima of the TAP free energy doesn't have any solution if you start with a state which has an energy larger than this threshold value. Okay? So this is another way of understanding that there is a limited region of minima or stationary points of the Hamiltonian, which can be followed in that then leads to minima of the TAP free energy. If you go too high in energy, then there is no minima of the TAP free energy corresponding to that stationary value. Okay? And you see from really the solution of the equation. But, okay, so this is an important condition. Then, in order to understand that there is a minimal value, you have to compute the complexity. There is no way, okay? You have to see that the complexity becomes negative. However, from once you understand that there is a, let me say, a range of energies, which is in the interesting one, actually, we know this from the zero temperature computation, you understand that there is a range of Z values. So let me say that the range of possible energies where the complexity is non-zero this maps uniquely on a range of z values, since this function is monotonously increasing, okay? So essentially, the overlap, because we are interested in computing the overlap for each of these states, and I want to convince you that this picture is reasonable. You want to solve this equation here in Q for Z taking one of the values in this range, which is the possible range, okay? And once you try to solve this equation in Q, this again is a nonlinear equation, so how can I solve it? Well, at least I can understand up to where there are solutions, and so I take the definition of Z, and I try to solve in Q the equation 1 minus Q, Q to the P half minus 1 equal to Z times the temperature. Now, if you do the plot of this, for example, for P equal 3, is a function between 0 and 1, which has a maximum. It starts this way. This is this function here. So what I learn without solving the nonlinear equation and just plotting this function has a maximum. So certainly, I'm not able to solve the equation when the temperature is too high, because Z times T, so I'm solving this equation equal to Z times T. If T is too high, I cannot solve it anymore, okay? So there is a maximum value for T such that this equation can be solved at fixed value of Z. Z, essentially, is a parameter for selecting one of the states that has a given energy at zero temperature. So fix Z and compute the maximum value of T that allows you to find an equation, a solution to this equation. This is very easy because you have to understand where is the maximum of this function. The maximum of this function is in a value that is called QA in the lecture notes by Alain Barra. So I will use this notation. And computing QA is just taking a derivative is such that the derivative of this with respect to Q is equal to zero. Well, I leave you for, as an exercise, it's very simple. It turns out to be 1 minus 2 over P, okay? So this is the value of QA. And the maximum of the function, so this function computed in QA is equal to 2 over P, 1 minus 2 over P to the power P half minus 1. Okay, something. There is a finite value. So now what happened is that this equation cannot be solved for T too large. For each value of Z, which means each value of the zero energy, you have a maximum value of the temperature such that you can solve the equation. And so from this, you can find a T max for each value of Z. So for each energy level of the zero temperature potential energy, you have a maximum value of T where you can solve the equation. And since Z and T enters in this way, if you take a larger Z, you have a smaller T max. And if you take smaller Z, you have a larger T max. So this picture is reasonable. It says that if you take the value, the states with the smallest value for the energy, so the smallest value for Z, have the maximum value for the temperature where I can solve this equation. So in some sense, I can follow this state up to this value, which is T max of, I label, instead of Z, I use E, okay, E min. While if I take these states, I can follow these states for up to a smaller T max. And so I can compute explicit expression I'm not interested in doing now for the range of validity for the range of temperature where this equation can be solved. Okay? So for each energy level I have here a line that I call T max of E that goes from T max of E threshold to E max of E min that define a region in the plane free energy as a function of temperature where solution to the TAP equation do exist. Okay? So essentially we uncover the region and we did the explicit computation of the region where there is an exponentially large number of minima of the TAP free energy. Okay? And if you look at the Q, which is one more physically interesting parameter to look at in order to understand how these states look like. If you do the same plot but for Q, now since you see from here that once you fix Z, well, there is a nonlinear equation, but for each value of T, you just have one value of Q. And changing Z is like rescaling the temperature. So you have exactly the same function, but with a temperature which is rescaled by a factor Z. So what happened is that all the curves start from 1, and then you will have something like this for the minimum energy, and something which follows exactly the same curve, but with a rescaled temperature, something like this. It's not exactly. Something like this for the threshold states. Okay? So all these states have this value for the self-overlap, and this will be T max of E threshold, and this will be T max of E min. Okay? So all this region is full of states, exponentially many. And in particular, let me write the, which will be useful for the following. In general, the explicit expression for the overlap or the free energy as a function of temperature are complicated nonlinear functions, so it's not worth writing it, but we'll see that threshold states will play a very important role for the dynamics. We'll see that essentially the dynamics will converge to threshold states, so it's worth writing now the explicit expression for Q and T for the threshold state. For the threshold states, we can take exactly this expression, but now if you take the explicit expression for Z threshold, which is defined, I just rewrite for you the expression for Z. You see, if you set E equal to E threshold, you have to set this to E threshold. So this cancel, and this expression simplifies square root of 2 over pp minus 1. So for the threshold state, the value for Z is particularly simple. You plug it here, and you realize that for the threshold states, you have the following equation for Q, which is the following. Beta square, you have to plug Z threshold there and take the square. Beta square times 1 minus Q threshold square P minus 1 half equal, times Q threshold to P minus 2 equal to 1. So essentially this is the equation satisfied by the threshold states. And we'll see that this is particularly relevant because we'll see that the dynamics tends to states having this value of the self-overlap. Okay? So this is just a completely thermodynamic computation. We are just computing how many minima there are for the TAP free energy. But later we realize that this value for the self-overlap of threshold states has an important role also in the dynamics. Okay? So this is why I write it for you explicitly. Now, let's come back to this picture here. And now, let's try to understand what happened to the thermodynamic of this model. Okay? So, we have a model where the free energy, assuming that the TAP free energy is a good description for the free energy of this system, has infinitely many minima in a wide region. On top of this, you have to remember that there is always one more state, which is the paramagnetic state. So there is always the paramagnetic solution, which is mi equal to zero for any spin, and the free energy is equal to minus beta over 4 minus, in the expression for the TAP free energy, I forgot to put also the term, the TAP free energy I wrote today, I forgot to put this term that is absent in half of the paper in the literature. So it's a completely irrelevant term. So enough of the paper is present, enough of the paper is absent, but it's worth keeping it. Otherwise, the free energy as a function of temperature doesn't have this shape, as a different shape, obviously, because one linear term is missing. So I can take this picture, which I know how to draw because I have all the equation, and I can add on top of it the paramagnetic free energy. And if I draw the paramagnetic free energy, what I found is something like this. Now it'd be very hard to draw a function that touches with the same derivative this curve in a point. Okay? So this is the F para. So it's reasonable that it has this shape because it needs to diverge as minus 1 over 4t here. It needs to go linearly, so this has to be linearly in t for large t, okay? So here it goes like minus t as infinity, and here diverges as minus 1 over 4t. So this shape is reasonable, so it must have a maximum somewhere. And what you find is absolutely non-trivial, is that in a point, it touches the region of where you have many minima of the TAP free energy. So now the question is, okay, I compute all these minima of the free energy, but I'm interested in the thermodynamics. When I do the thermodynamics in the canonical ensemble, what I'm interested in is in computing the canonical free energy, so the canonical partition function. So do all these states count for the partition function, or the partition function is dominated by the paramagnetic free energy, which, according to this plot, is always the smallest one. So if I have to choose which state dominates the thermodynamics from this plot, I should say always the green line. The other states, I did all this messy computation. Well, not so messy, but okay. It takes some time. And then it seems that for the thermodynamics are irrelevant because they always have a higher free energy. And what we learn from the thermodynamics of a canonical system, so a system put in contact with a bath of temperature T, is that you always have to choose the state with minimal free energy. Yes and no, in the sense that this plot is not telling you everything, because you have to remember that while there is just one unique paramagnetic state, there are many, exponentially many, states in this region here, okay? So if I want to understand correctly the weight of the paramagnetic state and let me call these spinless states, because they are spinless states, in the canonical partition function, have to take care of the fact that when computing the partition function, essentially I'm doing the sum, well, I should do the sum over the configuration, but if you, so the partition function is defined as the sum over the configuration of the Hamiltonian of the system, okay? Now, if you group the configuration state by state, so what you do, you are taking the space of all configuration, and you group the configuration in states, so these states alpha, this state beta, and this state gamma, okay? You are grouping the configuration, the relevant configuration in states, because actually, it's impossible to do a draw of a n-dimensional space where configurations are divided into states according to their weight. You can approximate this by the sum over the states of e to the minus beta n f alpha of the state, okay? So now the question is, as long as I have, as in the Curie-Weiss model, just two states, three states, the paramagnetic state and the ferromagnetic state, I just have to compare this free energy among two, three points. So I compare the free energy with m equals zero, with the free energy with m equal m naught, and I just check which one is larger. But now you have exponentially many states, because what we have seen is that each of these states, which are exponentially many, can be followed up in temperature by adding to the TAP free energy, the term, so the TAP free energy is just the energetic part plus this extra term, okay? So you add this extra term, which is the same for all the states of given energy, and you follow the state in temperature. So if you have infinitely many here, you also have infinitely many here, and infinitely many here. So now we have to do that sum over infinitely many states, and this may change the result, okay? So how do we do this sum? Well, we have to take care that the sum over the states can be converted in a sum, actually an integral, over free energy levels, okay? Sorry, one more important thing for this model, which is extremely simple, that each state follows a curve, and the curves never cross. This very peculiar of this model, which is extremely simple, is the reason why I'm teaching you this model, but this is unusual. Usually, the free energy of different states, they do what is called level crossing, so they cross. So a state which is dominating at one temperature is not dominating another temperature, and that makes everything much more messy. But for the moment, in this model, all the states remain with exactly the same order. So the free energies of two systems, they never cross. So this makes the computation simpler, because it means that the complexity that you compute at zero temperature can be transposed at finite temperature very easily. So you take this and you approximate as, actually, no, you compute exactly as an integral over f of what? The number of states at a given free energy times the contribution to the free energy, to the partition function of each state. Okay? If you do this, you realize that, well, for each free energy level, so for each level of free energy, the actual weight is the sum of this term plus this term. See? So you can, let me put together these two terms. So for each free energy level, free energy identifying state, you have something which is, well, let me put also the minus beta in front, n, you have f minus t sigma of f, okay? So this is the total free energy, the total weight of a given state, actually a given group of states having a certain free energy level. Okay? So as long as you solve the Kurzweil model where sigma is always zero, is enough to see which free energy is smaller. But now you have an extra term which you see plays the same role as an entropy. So usually the free energy is the internal energy minus Ts, where S is the internal entropy of a state. Now you have one more extra term, which is the complexity or the configurational entropy. This is why the name configurational entropy, which is telling you that on top of counting how many configurations you have within one state of a given free energy level, you have to count how many states of a given free energy level you have. And so this is an extra term in the entropy. Now, if you want to do a fair comparison between the paramagnetic solution, the paramagnetic state, and these states, these glassy states, you have to compare this term here, you have to compare it with the paramagnetic free energy. This is the right quantity to compare with the paramagnetic free energy. So let's do a comparison between this total free energy of a given group of states and the corresponding paramagnetic free energy. So you don't have to compare only what is plotted on this graph, because in this graph I'm just plotting F. I'm not including the complexity. So if you do this, you can redraw a different plot where you plot the total free energy. So F minus T sigma. And actually, in order to make the plot even more explicitly, let me draw F minus TS minus F para. So I'm already removing the paramagnetic free energy. Okay, so I'm just looking at the difference between the free energy of a given set of states, which is labeled by the energy, the zero temperature energy, and the paramagnetic free energy. If you do this and you redo the plot, what you find is that, for example, you have the minimal, so the states which have zero energy, zero temperature energy equal to E min, they touch at this point. And if you take the states E threshold, they touch in another point, okay? And then, obviously, this curve finish at T max of E threshold, while this curve finishes at T max of E min, as usual, because these are the endpoints of this curve. And by continuity, if you take any value of E between E min and E threshold, you have something in between which touches here, okay? So let me give some names to these two important temperatures. Let's call this TD is the dynamical critical temperature, and let me call this TC the static critical temperature or the condensation threshold, the condensation temperature. So what we learn from this new way of plotting exactly all the data we already have in our hand? We are learning that coming from high temperature, as long as you are here, the green region, the paramagnetic state is indeed the one having the smallest total free energy. Any other state has higher free energy. Okay? They all have higher free energy. Obviously, if I sum over all these states, since each one is subdominating and the weight is then multiplied by n, if for any value of f, this quantity is smaller, actually is larger than the paramagnetic free energy, this integral is subdominating with respect to the contribution to the partition function of the paramagnetic fixed point. At this temperature, you have that threshold states turns out to have exactly the same weight of the parametric state. These are infinitely many, because remember that the complexity for the threshold state is strictly positive. So these states are infinitely many in n. But at this point here, so let me draw now on this plot the TD and TC. These are TD and TC. At this temperature, this state that already arise at a higher temperature, they arise at a higher temperature, they were subdominant, they were irrelevant, but at this temperature, TD, they become of the same weight of the parametric state. Then you go down in temperature and you see that at each temperature, the free energy of the parametric solution is equivalent to the free energy of a subset of states labeled by a particular value of E. And if you draw this on this plot, you find a line like this, okay? So for each temperature between TD and TC, you have a specific value of the zero energy, of the zero temperature energy that selects a subset of states that turns out to have exactly the same free energy as the parametric solution in this region here, the red region. Okay, the red region is that one. Finally, below here, looking just at this data, one will say, okay, and here again, the parametric state is dominating because it's the smallest one. Okay, so in order to say, no, I don't want to take the parametric state here, but actually what we will see, what I will try to convince you that below TC you have to follow these states here in order to have the right physics. Well, this is impossible to say from this TAP computation. And actually, the reason why I will show you a dynamic computation is because I will try to convince you that at TD, at the dynamical threshold, at the dynamic transition temperature, actually there is an ergodicity breaking transition. What is an ergodicity breaking transition? We'll discuss in more detail, but actually in practice it means that you never forget the initial condition, which means you are within a valley. If I start a dynamics, a thermal dynamics, at a temperature below TD, and I try to go far away from the initial point, and I'm not able to do that, it means that there is an ergodicity breaking. So I'm in a valley. And so if at TD takes place an ergodicity breaking that makes relaxation to the parametric state impossible, well, it's impossible that here I have ergodicity breaking and then at a lower temperature I recover ergodicity. This is impossible. So if a structure of state already arises, I will keep that structure of states even at lower temperature. And so this means that at lower temperature I have to select only among spin-glass states those that actually dominates the thermodynamics. So I have to forget about the parametric solution. And so only among these states I have to take those of the lowest free energy, lowest total free energy, so this quantity here. And those of lowest total free energy are this one, because all the others are higher free energy, okay? So let me do yes. Mm-hmm. Okay, so this is more or less everything you can get from the TAP solution. One more relevant relation that will be useful
why for t greater than t
Let me do it more explicitly. You're right. So, this is an important point to understand in the right way. So, I write the Z as the sum over all states of the exponential minus beta n, the free energy of the states. Now, from the minima of the TAP, so TAP free energy, we know that there are many possible states. There is one which is the parametric state. So let me rewrite this as the contribution from the parametric state, which is exponential of minus beta n f para, plus the contribution from the exponentially many states having free energy in a range which is fully determined by, well, by the solution of the TAP equation. Okay, so I have on top of this the integral from f min from to f threshold, which is essentially these two values here. So I call f min the free energy corresponding to e min, and f threshold the free energy corresponding to e threshold. Df, so the number of states is given by exponential of sigma of f, and each state has a contribution beta nf. Okay? Now, let me, so you see that what I'm doing, essentially, I'm here, so let me put this term in front of everything. So I can rewrite this as exponential by minus beta n f para times what? Times 1 plus, so I'm putting this in front of everything, the integral between f min to f threshold df exponential of minus beta n times what is f minus t sigma of f minus the term that I put in front here. Here I have to compensate f para. Okay? So the quantity within the square, the internal square bracket, I use square bracket twice, this quantity here is the one I'm plotting here. So what happened? If this quantity is strictly positive, this means that the integrand is exponentially small in n. When I take the thermodynamic limit, if this quantity is always positive, this integral is much smaller than 1. Because I'm doing the integral of exponential of minus n something strictly positive. On the contrary, so you can rewrite this. Let me rewrite this introducing a quantity that will be useful in a while. This 1 plus, and do the integral by the Laplace method. So you essentially, you say that the integral is dominated by the value of f, which makes the exponent maximum. Okay? So I introduce the notation. Let me write and then define beta n f star minus t sigma of f star minus f para, where f star is defined as the quantity that minimizes that expression. So let me define it here. Where f star is defined as the arg min over f in this range here. So you take all the values between f min and f threshold, and you compute the arg min of this quantity. Actually, f para is a constant in f. It's just the parametric free energy that we put in order to compute the free energy difference, but the dependence on F is just in F minus T sigma. So we have to do the arg min of F minus T sigma of F. So if we define F star as this, the argument that minimizes the total free energy, so the total free energy has a free energy term and a complexity term, that now we see what I was trying to describe to you with that plot, that is, F star now is the, well, here I'm plotting already the minimum computed of F star, so the lowest curve corresponds to, over all the values of F, the lowest value is achieved in F star. F star is the quantity that achieves the minimum of F minus T sigma. So as long as F star is zero here, this term is equal to this term, which is the... So as long as all this quantity computed on the minimum value is zero, which is here, then 1 and the exponential of 0 are equal. So essentially, the weight of the states, infinitely many eventually, states equal the weight of the paramagnetic state in the partition function. While if the minimum among, so if S star is such that this quantity is still strictly positive, then in the thermodynamic limit, this is irrelevant with respect to 1. And this means that above the first point where the lowest among this curve touches the axis, for t larger than td, all the curves, and so even the lowest one, is strictly positive. If it is strictly positive, then this quantity is strictly positive. This means that there is a strictly positive free energy difference between the total free energy that you can achieve with spinless states and the total free energy that you have with a paramagnetic state. And if this quantity is positive, this term is going to zero in n very fast. And so the paramagnetic state is the one leading the giving you the leading term to the partition function. Okay? So, recapitulating, for in general, every time you have a situation like this with a range of free energies where you have a non-zero complexity, so these are a generic situation, so every time you have something like this, you can do this computation, so you can take the canonical partition function, splitting, dividing the paramagnetic state, the spinless states with non-zero complexity, so the range is fixed by the condition that the complexity must be strictly positive and it must exist. So typically, above the threshold state, you have some condition such that the complexity is not well defined, and below the minimum energy, the complexity becomes negative. You can do this computation that essentially leads you to understand that the temperature range can be divided in three regions. One region where the paramagnetic state is dominating, and so the integral over all the spinless states is subdominant in the thermodynamic limit. A region where there is a subset, but still exponentially many, of spinless states which have essentially the same weight as the paramagnetic state. And so this means that there is a competition between the paramagnetic state and an infinite many spinless states. So they have the same weight in the partition function. And then finally, there is another region where you don't longer have this equality, so in principle, the paramagnetic state should again dominate, but actually, I will try to convince you that in this region, you have to take the lowest spinless states, okay? So the paramagnetic state should be abandoned below the dynamical threshold because of something that we can better understand only via a dynamical computation that we do. Okay? So now we take a break and then we continue to show you how to compute all this with replicas. Okay, so first of all, I just want to do a caveat in the sense that pictures are actually always expanded in some direction just to make the draw more clear to read, but you can do it really by, for example, drawing this function in Mathematica and the situation, maybe this is much thinner and then this curve, this red curve, maybe is even going up, but okay. If I do it this way, it's very exaggerated, but it's just in order to allow you to visualize better where the curves meet. Okay, so don't take it too seriously from the quantitative point of view. It's qualitatively correct, but if you want to do it quantitatively, just put the equation into Mathematica. It's not hard to do this kind of plot because it's true that the equation for Q is nonlinear, but you can always do parametric plots. So you can use Q as the independent variable and then write in the temperature as a function of Q, and everything then is analytic. It's really very simple expression. So every time you want to do this kind of plot, use Q as the independent variable in a parametric plot, and everything is very simple. So what I would like to do now is to spend some more time to give you, an intuition, some image that you can save in your mind about what's happening in this system. Because actually, it's not easy to understand why and how can the parametric state be equivalent to some infinitely many states. So what does it mean? We started all this discussion about disordered systems. Say, disordered systems have many states. We want to understand how the thermodynamic changes in presence of many states, and this is what we are doing now. And so I want to try to be a little bit more explicit and try to make maybe some cartoon that can be a little bit more easy to keep in mind. Okay, so as a function of temperature, I want to try to give you an idea of what's happening when we meet the dynamic and the what is called TVA, static phase transition. Okay, so then we discuss which kind of phase transition is from the point of view of the derivative of the free energy. But first of all, let me try to give you a picture, a very simple picture of what's happening between these two temperatures, where we found coincidence between the paramagnetic free energy and the free energy of this subset of spin glass states. Okay? So the idea is that when you have a paramagnetic solution, what does it mean? A paramagnetic solution, you have all the magnetization equal to zero. This means that spins are mostly uncorrelated. So in the system, in your system, there are very weak correlation, and almost all configuration are, let me say, I don't want to say equiprobable because they are not equiprobable, but if you look at the space of configuration, let me draw here the space of configuration, and let me draw only configuration which have a probability which is not too small. By this concept, not too small, obviously, you have to think that each point has a probability exponential of beta h of s. So the concept of not too small is very difficult. But still, what we have in mind is that in a paramagnetic state where minimization are zero, essentially every variable can be flipped without any problem, because otherwise I could not reach this, okay? So suppose that you run a Monte Carlo, or suppose that you do a random walk only among configuration which have a high enough probability, okay? And it's important to understand what is the topology of this space of configuration which are probable enough. And what happens is that essentially all these configurations are more or less connected. So let me draw something which is there are regions, okay? So this, there are some holes, but essentially all the space is well connected. So if you do a random walk in this space of configuration which have a weight large enough, you can essentially visit all the configurational space. In other words, if you run a Monte Carlo, I know that the students from the master, they run a lot of Monte Carlo, this system is ergodic. It means that you can go with a non-zero probability from any configuration to any other configuration. Eventually, you have to wait a little bit, but you can do it, even in the thermodynamic limit. So even for n very large, you can always go from any point to any other point. This is what is called ergodicity. It means that you can build on this space of configuration a dynamical process, which is called, for example, a Markov chain, which allows you to visit the space according to this probability, and if ergodicity is not broken, you can go from any configuration to any other configuration moving according to this probability. So the probability, there are no, let me say, regions, no man's land region where you cannot enter because the probability is too small. Now, what happened at this point, essentially, is that this space of, let me say, allowed configuration, so configuration which have a weight which is sensibly different from zero, splits, okay, in subregions, exponentially many. So what happened? And notice the following. So if you take the sum over all this region, you get exactly the same result that you will get assuming that there was a paramagnetic state. Okay? What I mean, assuming that there was a paramagnetic state, when you say the paramagnetic state has all zero magnetization, it means that you are assuming that any dynamical process that sample configuration according to this probability law can visit, can flip any spin, because if you start from here and you sample according to this probability law and you have all magnetization equal to zero, it means that you can flip any spin. Actually, this true, let me say more correctly. So the free energy, the partition function of this system, so this again is the space of configuration, and this is the probability, which is now it is sensibly different from zero only in a subset of points. If you take the sum over all these points, you get the same result as if you were assuming the paramagnetic assumption is correct. But that assumption is no longer correct. It's just a coincidence that the sum actually, doing the replica computation, we will understand better why the coincidence holds. But still, it's just a coincidence that the partition function computed on this system that has been split in subsystems is equal to what you get assuming paramagnetic assumption. So all spins essentially uncorrelated. But if you now run a dynamics, so you start from a given configuration and you check how far you can go by doing local moves, so you again you build the same Markov chain that you do in Monte Carlo simulation, you get stuck. You don't move, okay? Your maximum distance you can travel is essentially, so the maximum distance you travel, so the correlation, we'll introduce this later, but the correlation between time t and time zero, it goes to q. Q is the order parameter that we introduced before, okay? So essentially, as long as q is different from zero, it means that you don't decorrelate from the initial configuration. So the coincidence with the free energy of the paramagnetic solution is just, let me say, is confusing. It's confusing in the sense that you believe that the paramagnetic assumption is still correct, but it's not, okay? This is why below this point, you have to abandon this assumption. It's wrong. It's not true that the system is completely ergodic and you can flip any variable without altering the other variables. Now variables are strongly correlated. And if you want to flip one variable, you have to go from this state maybe to this other state. In order to do this, you have to flip altogether maybe half of the variables of the system. And this is not a local move, it's a global move, very hard to do. And if you run a local algorithm, there is no way of going out from this state. So this state is meaningful, the paramagnetic state is no longer meaningful. And so, since the free energy of the computation under the paramagnetic assumption is equal to this computation, we have to take this computation for true, and the paramagnetic computation wrong, okay? Then you decrease further the temperature, and what we realize is that, okay, we change the states that are dominating the thermodynamics, and eventually you reach the lowest one. The lowest one have zero complexity. What does it mean? They are no longer exponentially many. So here you have the complexity which is strictly positive. At TC, the states that are dominating the computation of the partition function, they have the minimum free energy, which actually corresponds to the minimum energy and to zero complexity. So this means that you end up with very few states, maybe just one, two, three, but a sub-exponential number of states, okay? So now sigma is zero, and the number of states is sub-exponential. It's not just one or two. Maybe it's a small number, but it's a number which does not increase exponentially in n. It can even eventually increase polynomially in n, but not exponentially, okay? And so this is why this transition is also called condensation transition. It's actually the measure condensate in a very small subset of states, okay? So this usually also called condensation phase transition. The Gibbs measure, which was split in this model, equally split, in other models not equally split, but it was split on exponentially many states, when the complexity goes to zero, it concentrates in a sub-exponential number of states. This is what produces very strong correlation, because, well, I don't have time to tell you everything, but if you take the average of any correlation function on all these exponentially many states, you get, again, by that coincidence, exactly the result that you will get under the paramagnetic assumption. So any correlation among a finite number of spins here is zero. Well, it's trivial. Don't want to say it's zero, because if you have an external field, then it's non-zero, but is as if you were in the paramagnetic assumption. So very weak correlation among variables. While here, and this happens essentially because in each state, maybe two spins, if you look just at two spins, they were positive correlated in half of the states and negatively correlated in the other half. You take the average over all the states and you get zero. Even if on each, within each state, they have a non-zero overlap, so they are really correlated within each state. But then you take the average over the state and any correlation goes to zero. Here, no, because now the number of states is very small. So if you end up with three states, now the probability that those two variables are exactly positive and negative correlated in half of the state and half of the state now is improbable, because with few states, each state has correlation, and you don't have any longer an infinite number of states to average over. And so here, correlation becomes really different from zero. You have to look at the right correlation, but anyhow, here you can detect that there is a long-range correlation even from a thermodynamic point of view. Indeed, if we now try to understand, so can we classify this kind of phase transition from the classical Ehrenfest classification, which says the order of the phase transition is given by the first derivative of the free energy, which is singular or diverging, but okay, it's not well defined, okay? So for example, in first order phase transition, you have that the first derivative of the free energy is singular, while in second order phase transition, you have that the second derivative of the free energy is divergent, okay? So here the situation is more complicated. It's more complicated essentially because the total free energy at TD has no change at all, because in all this region, the total free energy that you get from these states, from these spin glass states, is identical to the parametric free energy. So here, the free energy is given by the parametric result. Here is given by another result, which is identical to the one you get from the parametric assumption. So crossing TD, there is no singularity at all. It's the same function. So if you draw it, it's the green line. No change at all. While here, if you notice, there are some singularities. And actually, you can compute it and realize that the singularity arises in the second derivative, okay? So you have to be careful, because this is a strange phase transition, because from the point of view of the free energy, so there is a, let me say, essentially there is a jump in the second derivative of the free energy with respect to, which is proportional, now I don't remember, to the specific heat, okay? So from the point of view of the thermodynamics, the first derivative of the free energy is continuous, while the second derivative has a jump. So it looks like a second order phase transition. But from the point of view of the order parameter, it's not. Why? Well, because we know that the order parameter here is the overlap, is something that is telling us whether I'm in the, what is the order parameter? In the Curie-Weiss model was the magnetization. In general, it's a number that tells you in which phase you are. So if I have a number, in this case Q, which is equal to zero in the parametric phase and non-zero in a spin glass state, I can use it as an ordered parameter. The problem is that now if I look at the plot I made before, where I have this for all the TAP states, and in particular I realize that the one corresponding to the lowest free energy states have the highest overlap, it's clear that the overlap of the parametric solution is always zero. So at a certain point, I will have a jump. Well, actually, you have a jump even before, because the jump is already present at TD. So at TD is here. Here is TD. So already at TD, have a jump. then I continue up, and eventually I merge at TC with this branch here, okay? So from the point of view of the overlap, I have a jump, both at TD and then at TC I also have another singularity. But from the point of view of the order parameter, these are first order transition. The order parameter has a discontinuity, has a jump, as in a standard first order transition. So it looks like a second order transition from the point of view of thermodynamic quantities, but it looks like a first order transition from the point of view of the order parameter. So this is a very peculiar phase transition. It means the order parameter has a jump, so there is a drastic change in the order parameter from Q equals zero, so no correlation at all, to Q different from zero, strong correlation. This usually what happens in first order phase transition. When you have a first order phase transition, for example, the model I, the classical model I was referring during my last lecture, the classical ferromagnetic three-spin model that you can solve because it's fully connected, so you can write explicitly the free energy has minus m cube plus t the entropy, which is the usual entropy, okay? So it's very easy to solve. If you look at the free energy as a function of m, first you have a minimum in m equals zero, and when you reach the critical point, you have a jump from m equals zero to m non-zero, okay? So the magnetization, if you look at the magnetization as a function of temperature, you clearly have a jump, okay? But in standard, in non-disordered models, when you do have a jump in the order parameter, you typically have a discontinuity in the first derivative of f. Why? Very simple, because the magnetization, the thermodynamic magnetization is just given by the derivative of the free energy with respect to the one of the parameters, okay? So if you have a jump in this, you have a jump in this. And so there is always very related the order parameter to the derivative of the free energy. Here in this order system, the situation is much more complicated because you see that the order parameter is not directly related to any derivative of the free energy. Actually, we spend a lot of time trying to understand what is the order parameter. Is the sum of this magnetization that are the minima of the TAP free energy. I don't have an external parameter to couple with the order parameter. So I don't have a field to couple with the magnetization as in this case. And this is the reason why the derivative of the free energy are not directly related to the order parameter, because there is no field to couple with the order parameter, okay? Actually, we'll see that now we'll introduce a field of this type, and so in that sense, you can introduce some, sorry, it's not true. I will show you that you can actually introduce a new parameter that is coupled to this overlap, but it's not one of the standard parameters, so not the temperature, the external field, is a new, somehow more, well, has some meaning, but is not a parameter that you can tune in the experimental lab, okay? While external fields, temperature, you can tune it in an experimental lab. So this system have a phase transition that from the point of view of the experimentalist, so people that can vary the temperature, the external field, the density of some particles, they don't have any strong singularity in the first order derivative. While in the order parameter, which is a strange object because it's the similarity between two copies of the two systems put in the same state, they have a jump, so a first order phase transition. The name of this kind of phase transition is random first order transition. So if you find the RF of T in the literature, it means this kind of phase transition. So a phase transition where you do have a first order phase transition, because you clearly see in the order parameter that you have a jump, but because of the randomness, this does not immediately reflect in a singularity of first order derivative of the free energy. You have a singularity in the first order derivative of the free energy only if you couple with a proper parameter that is coupled to exactly this overlap. So since this temperature here and the corresponding self-overlap value will play an important role in the dynamics that we will solve later, I leave you as an exercise to check the following. It's just algebra, but okay. Try to do it, otherwise just believe me. If you take so let me call QD the value of the overlap at TD. So the value of the overlap of the threshold states, because these are threshold states, at the temperature where the threshold states becomes as important as they dominate the thermodynamics, essentially, okay? So check that if you take QD equal to P half, P minus 2 over P minus 1, and this value for TD, so in principle you can derive everything, but it's much simpler that I give you the values and then these are strange but at least explicit expression. You can check that these states, so the states that are temperature TD, with self-overlap QD, you can check two things. They satisfy the equation for, QD is equal to Q threshold for T equal TD. The equation for Q threshold was, I gave it to you during the first hour. And second, you can check that the sigma of this and you can check that the total free energy, so FTAP of QD and TD minus TD sigma computed on these states, so on QD and TD, is equal to F para. So essentially you have to take the TAP free energy, plug this expression, I give it to you in the previous lecture, the explicit expression for sigma, that you will see that once you plug into sigma, Z equals Z threshold, because these are threshold, you just compute these are threshold states. So you just check that at this temperature, the states which have this overlap are actually threshold states. So you can use Z equals Z threshold in all your analytic expression, and you can compute that this equality holds. So you are checking that at this temperature, the states with this overlap are threshold states, and they have the same weight of the parametric free energy, okay? This will be useful because these two expressions, we derive it from the dynamics. So I will prove you in the next lecture that if you run the dynamics at this temperature, you get trapped at this value for the correlation. So you don't decorrelate, you go to that value. So This is just to say that this red point is very relevant for the dynamics. Okay? Okay, so before moving to starting the replica computation, let me just tell you well, no, we can do it all together, I think. Now, let me just tell you one more practical point, which is the following. Suppose that you just compute the complexity curve, and I will show you in the next lecture how to do it with replicas, but for the moment we have an expression for, so suppose that someone gives you, or you compute it, sigma of f, and notice that this expression in principle depends also on the temperature, so I can put the temperature here, for example, okay, because in particular we know the expression for this at zero temperature. I give it to you explicitly, but you have to compute it at any temperature, because it's true that the states, the zero temperature states evolve in temperature, but this sigma of f may deform a little bit. Actually, the dependence on the temperature, we put it here because it's always very mild, okay? So if you look at this function for different values of temperature, the main effect is that it's shifted. So for example, at zero temperature, it looks like this, and then at a positive temperature, maybe it looks like this. It's mainly shifted, but the shape is more or less preserved, so it's very weakly dependent on temperature. Anyhow, in principle, it depends on temperature. So the question is, suppose that this is given, either you compute it at zero temperature, and then you compute the TAP states corresponding to that zero temperature energy, or you compute it by replicas, as we will do now. How can you compute TD and TC from the knowledge of this function? Okay? So now you want to understand what are the critical temperature, which is something relevant for your model. And what you have to do, you have to compute this quantity, which is the free energy minimizing, remember, in this range, F minus T sigma. I will use temperature, inverse temperature mixed. You, please forgive me, but it's impossible to use only beta or only T. So you have to accept that T and beta, 1 over T, are always mixed. So essentially, if you take, in order to compute this minimum, you can take the derivative with respect to F of this expression. So computing this minimum is equivalent to take the derivative with respect to F and set the derivative of sigma with respect to F equal to 1 over T, so equal to beta, okay? But you have to check that a point where the derivative of sigma with respect to F is equal to beta does actually exist. So you draw your sigma of F, usually this ends in a point with a non-zero slope. And so there are at least two main important slopes in this plot, which are the slope in this point and the slope in this point here. Why? Because you're looking for a point along this curve, actually for a free energy value, such that the slope is equal to beta. Okay? But when you change the temperature, actually it may happen that the slope with the right, sorry, the slope with the right value is beyond this point or beyond this point, and this is to be excluded. Okay? So as long as this equation can be solved between this point and this point is fine. Otherwise, you are above TD or below TC. So essentially, TD is the first point where this equation can be solved for the threshold states, while TC is the last temperature where this equation can be solved in the allowed range F min S threshold, and so it corresponds to this point here. Okay? So if we give names to these thresholds, so these slopes, let me call this slope here MS of T, and this slope here M threshold of T. Essentially, in general, you have that from the plot, you see that in general, you have M threshold of T is smaller than MS of T for any temperature, okay? Because sigma of F has always a downwards curvature, as any good entropy. Otherwise, if it doesn't have a downwards curvature, you have to reject all the parts of this function which have the wrong curvature, okay? So these are physical requirements. You can prove that this is because otherwise you don't have a thermodynamically stable solution. Moreover, you have this threshold may vary with the temp, this slope, sorry, may vary with temperature, but usually they don't vary very much, okay? In particular, this one, they vary a little bit. So in practice, when you solve this, you have to solve something like the dynamic temperature is the first point where the threshold, the slope at the threshold at TD is equal to beta. Okay? Yes. And the critical temperature, the condensation temperature, is the point where MS of TC is equal to beta. Beta, let me write this way, 1 over TD, and this 1 over TC. And you see that the fact that MS is usually larger than M threshold makes TC smaller. Suppose that these two numbers are practically temperature independent, makes TC smaller than TD, obviously. So essentially, what's happening is that when you decrease the temperature, you are increasing beta. So you are looking for the point along this curve where the slope is always larger, okay? So you have a first point where essentially, I wrote something wrong, so forget this. No, this, we have to discuss, let me discuss only forget this, let me discuss only this point for determining the static transition temperature. The other one, I said something wrong. So essentially you look for the point where the slope is always larger and larger in order to satisfy this equation, but at a certain point, since this function reaches zero with a finite slope, you have a point where you are able to solve this equation. Okay? From that point below, so when beta is even larger, essentially this point is dominating the argmin. Because you have to remember that the argmin is taken with respect to the region where sigma is positive defined. So this region essentially is the region where sigma of F is non-negative, okay? And so if you want to take the argmin over this region, essentially the slope at this point is what determines the thermodynamic transition, okay? So this is the way, once you have sigma of f, of determining the thermodynamic transition. Because the other transition you have to compare for the other transition you have to compare f minus t sigma with f para, so it's not only related to the slope, okay? So we have to do something more complicated. And let me just add one more information that you may useful when you read the literature. This phenomenon of the complexity becoming zero at a given point is usually called in the structural glasses literature, so people working on glass form and liquids, is called the entropy crisis. Scenario. What does it mean? It means that essentially at a certain temperature, which is defined by this condition, the entropy goes to zero, and so essentially at that point you have a phase transition because you have a condensation. And it's called, with this term, because in glass former liquids, experimentalists realized that there should be some kind of phase transition of this kind, because what they did, they computed the entropy of a liquid that you can do experimentally in the high temperature, if you want to use this jargon, or in the low density, if you are looking for system that which can make denser and denser and make it slower and slower by packing more and more sphere, more and more colloids. But let's speak in terms of temperature. So you have a high temperature system where you can compute the entropy, and even if the system becomes slower and slower, so it becomes, from the point of view of the experiment, more and more difficult to follow, because obviously you have to wait hours, then you have to wait days, and then you are no longer able to do computation. If you draw, so you can study a system that becomes slower and slower for a given time, not more than days, because then the experimental setup becomes unstable. But you can do the following. You can compute the entropy of the liquid, and you subtract the entropy of the solid, or of of the solid. And here, suppose that there is some temperature. They take measure, and what they realize, here the system is becoming slower and slower, so you are not really able to follow the system. But they realize that taking the extrapolation, they get a negative difference in the entropy. This, just to, this roughly speaking, the complexity. So the idea is that the system is more or less trapped in a limited region. Anyhow, from the experimental point of view, the entropy of a liquid cannot be smaller than the entropy of the solid. The solid is much more ordered, okay, as much less freedom, so it cannot be negative. And so they realize that before reaching this point, there should be some transition, okay? Maybe an entropy-driven transition where the system is no longer able to explore a large part of the phase space, but is actually really concentrated in a sub-part of the phase space. And so this is why it's called the entropy crisis scenario. You have the difference between two entropies that you can experimentally compute, they go to zero, so most probably what happened before is that there is a phase transition where the entropy remains very small, eventually goes to zero, just at zero temperature, satisfying the Nernst theorem, okay? So somewhere there should be a phase transition, the system has to change. It cannot be longer a liquid. This is a very slow liquid, so it cannot be a liquid forever, because otherwise it would be a liquid with an entropy which is smaller than the solid. This cannot exist. So the liquids must must make a phase transition to a different kind of long-range order, a different kind of organization, and this is the let me say the mean field scenario, because here we are dealing with mean field models that is likely, well, it gives you one possible scenario. So you have a condensation on a subset of systems, and so this is the parametric free energy is no longer the good one, and you have to move to another solution, which is the Spin-Glass solution below this temperature. Okay, so this is just to say that all these mean field models that looks in some sense not too realistic, actually they can be very very useful in understanding real and very interesting from the point of view of physics phenomena. Okay, so obviously we'll do not today all the replica calculation, but let me just start telling you. So now our aim is to compute this. If we have this, we have everything. If we are able to compute the complexity, so how many states do we have at a given temperature, given free energy, we are happy. Then we solve the thermodynamics, we compute this slope, and we understand where is the static critical temperature. We match the TAP free energy with the parametric free energy. We understand where is the dynamic threshold. Okay, so we understand everything. We have to compute this. So how can we compute the it's alpha 4. Okay, perfect. So see you tomorrow.